Trust the experts at A1 Quick Oil to take care of your most important possession, your vehicle. A1 has the latest technology and the training to handle any problem. And with old-fashioned service, they'll treat you like family. Go see Bobby to solve all your car problems today.
Here at A1, we don't work on cars. We fix them.
Carlee Gonzales is, of course, a well-known member of the Hammond City Council. At a time when there's a lot going on, a lot not going on. Let's start with what everybody is talking about, namely the so-called homeless shelter coming to Hammond. You say it can't be stopped, but it can be controlled, and the council is moving in that direction.
Yeah, so originally the property was purchased, honestly, without much conversation or any conversation at the city. So they've already purchased the property under what they thought was group living. And we looked at the Unified Development Code, the city's UDC, and I mean, I don't think it was very clear that that was a use that was described under group living. So I initially proposed an ordinance to define what homeless shelters were and then sent that to the planning and zoning so that they could come up with a proper definition for a homeless shelter. And what they did was even better, which they've done different categories of group living, given homeless shelters a definition and provided where they can go in the city. It is properly zoned where this group has purchased that property, the old Baymont Inn. But what they've done is provided that a homeless shelter can be in conditional use. The purpose of that is to make sure that the concerns of the citizens are met, like what conditions can we put on it? Well, a lot of people have said they're worried about fencing, they're worried about security, they're worried about lighting, all of those kinds of things, making sure that we're actually providing for people who are in the city or in the parish. And so those are conditions that eventually could be set, and we're going to have some more debate and conversations for both sides of the project to determine what conditions should go on this.
Is it a problem that when you use the term homeless, you're describing several different types of people? Some may be addicts, some may be criminals, some may be like you and me, just having had a few hard turns in life. So it's hard to get a handle on just what type of person we're talking about.
Sure, and then there's also issues of what is a homeless shelter? What does that mean? Is it individual rooms? Is it bunk housing where there's a lot of people living all in one area? This project is not that. It is individual rooms. I've been told that this group, they have a very good vetting system where they make sure that there's no criminal record, there's no sex offenses by the person, they don't tolerate drug and alcohol. So those are the kind of things that are would make a successful homeless shelter in my opinion. But we just want to make sure that not only this group, but any other group that may take over or want to do a homeless shelter, they have those protections in place for our city.
Wouldn't you agree, though, most people in Hammond, if they could vote, they don't want it?
It's split. Honestly, I've heard it from both sides. There's a lot of people who are coming out in support. Now, there's a lot of people who are not city residents in that group of people asking for it. But there are certainly some loud voices in the community that do want it because they see the need. We have homeless people in the city of Hammond. A lot of us don't see them, or we see one or two. But it is a problem, and so, but there are also, obviously, those business owners who were right there. They didn't have a say-so that this was going to be done, and I think that they're upset about it, and they want to protect that area of Hammond and make sure if it's done, that it's done right.
So do you think that it's a new ordinance, think that it does the trick?
I think it addresses the concerns, and it deals with what we've been handed. Right. They also have an access problem, which is completely outside the city's control. We have nothing to do with. They purchase property that they don't necessarily have a right of way or access to, and that's going to have to shake out in the courts that we don't have anything to do with. But that issue has given us the ability to make good government rules on how to regulate and make conditions on it.
So is there a target date for the ribbon cutting?
No, not that I'm aware of. I know that I think they applied for an occupational license, which they can't get because they don't have a legal access to the property. I've been told that if they had access, they could open at least a phase one, but I don't know how much that is. I don't know the timeline.
Well, in the meantime, you know, the biggest thing maybe was not on the agenda, namely an election apparently coming up on the big presidential ballot to determine whether or not the city council would have the right to fire the police chief. It's clearly targeted against the current police chief, but that doesn't make it any less effective. I mean, essentially, a vote yes is a vote for a new police chief.
Potentially it could be. So what's on the ballot is a charter amendment to amend our charter to allow the city council to fire the police chief. So it's specific to the police department, doesn't deal with the fire department or any other department head, and that vote would be a 3-2 vote. So whenever this was being debated by the council and when it was sent to the ballot, I said, well, let's make it a 4-1, a supermajority vote, or a 5-0 unanimous vote for something this drastic, because I think it creates multiple bosses for the police chief. But that's not, the other council members didn't have any say-so over that, or they actually didn't even comment on that. And so now it's a 3-2 vote to fire the police chief, which I think is not a good way of doing government.
Matter of fact, most people believe that this would not be legal if somebody was willing to go all the way in the court system. Now, you're obviously an attorney, the only one on the, well, no, I guess you're one of two on the council. But in any case, explain what's at work here. If nobody challenges it, then it flies.
I would assume so. Yeah, I mean, I guess it would need a challenge to determine. Now, it had to go to the bonding commission. I'm not sure they looked at the merits or the legality of it. I think we wait and see how people vote on it and whether it passes, and they can address that if somebody wants to challenge it. I personally would be voting no, because I think that there's no reason to give a majority vote to be able to fire someone, anyone. This is not how the city's ever done it, and I think it's a bad step forward.
Because essentially, if the mayor says one thing and the three city councilmen say the other thing, then the police chief, he loses whatever he does.
Right. And then even if this is targeted at Chief Bergeron, this is setting a precedent, or setting a method for just controlling the police chief. Who would want that job? You know, the next chief to come in, who would want that job? They can be fired at any time by just making three people on the council upset.
Or the mayor.
Well, that's already how it is. Make the mayor upset, you're gone. But if you make three council members upset, but two council members and the mayor are okay, it doesn't make sense to me.
That's the way it happens if nobody challenges it in court.
And it passes, yeah. That would be what happens.
Well, also, you're working on the final stages of the budget, which we ought to talk about, because it's, the most important thing is having the money to spend whatever you want to do, and that starts on July 1st, right?
Correct. We passed the budget last night at a council meeting, and we, you know, the city of Hammond's been doing great with tax revenue, sales tax revenue, and all the other revenues that come in. So we have a good budget. We have a lot of good capital projects coming in, a lot of sidewalk and drainage projects this year. We don't have much of any, we have one street project, but the parish is doing streets every 2 years. We kind of piggyback on with them, so we don't have any much needed street repairs this budget, but hopefully next year we're going to hit that hard. We got a little money coming in for each park, but we've had a lot of improvements to the parks lately, so we're just maintaining. We've got some money in the parks already, so we just added a little bit to that.
Sales tax is up, which is rather surprising, because last year was up a lot, and everybody assumed all the COVID money would fade away, and that this year we were bound to see a downturn, but that hasn't happened yet.
It hasn't, and we're projecting a little bit of an increase just so we can cover everything. I mean, we had to amend last budget to show the increased sales tax that were over in what we originally budgeted. So I guess it's just a testament of people of Hammond being a great place to shop, a great place to spend your money, and it certainly is a great place to live.
And the growth continues. I mean, the rents amaze me. Also, what people are willing to pay for a lot on certain streets, to even tear down a house to get the lot underneath it on Church Street.
Yeah, so that's my district. There's a whole lot of places in my district where property, like lot sales, are just outrageously high, but, you know, everybody wants to live there, so.
I mean, it's just a booming economy these days.
It is. It's great. I hope we stay that way.
And today, here at the Kiwanis Club, we're going to hear from Niagara, which is the big bottling plant in Robert, but just another example of a big payroll coming to this area, and they pay excellent salaries.
Yeah, great jobs, getting people to want to, who are living here, who can work here. You know, Hammond's a great place to live, but we want people to be able to work here too, spend their tax dollars here, buy homes here, and just continue to make this a better place. And people like Niagara certainly add to our city.
What else do you want to share with us?
Well, we have the 4th of July coming up, of course. Hammond has one of the best fireworks displays around. So we'll be doing that again on 4th of July. At Zemurray, yes, from 6 to 9. Everybody always asks what time the fireworks start. It's not till dark, so you got to wait till dark. Unfortunately, all the kids get to stay up a little bit later, but it's totally worth it. It's a great show, so we're looking forward to that.
Hi, I'm Trent Anthony with Monument Real Estate. After working several years in the real estate industry, I decided to serve the wonderful people of Southeast Louisiana by opening a locally owned company where each client is treated with a tremendous amount of respect and importance. Serving the North Shore, Baton Rouge, and New Orleans regions, Monument has the ability to broker all types of real estate transactions. Your real estate needs are very important to us, so let me or one of our team members help you make your mark with Monument Real Estate.